Dear viewers of Acti.com, Vaivathi from Pondicherry. Good evening. Today, I am going to discuss another most important chapter in organic chemistry, that is reaction and mechanism. Today, I am going to discuss what is a chemical reaction, what are the types of chemical reactions, what is mechanism, and what are the types of mechanisms. So when we are discussing about the chemical reactions, we must know the difference between organic reaction and inorganic reactions. Reactions involving inorganic compounds, they are very fast because they are ionic in nature. Compounds are ions. Whereas in the case of organic reactions where neutral molecules are involved, the reaction will be very slow comparatively. With this basic idea, let me enter into the topic, a reaction and a mechanism. What is a chemical reaction? The definition is this. A chemical reaction is one where the reactants undergo chemical combination to produce products through transition state or intermediates. This is the important definition for any chemical reaction. It may be organic, it may be inorganic, you can apply this. Okay, see, even I can apply for in organic reaction. Let me repeat again. A chemical reaction is one where the reactants undergo chemical combination to produce products through transition state or intermediates. Reactants here, I have given a specific example, chlorination of methane in presence of sunlight is a specific example I have taken. So in this case, methane and the chlorine are the reactants, left hand side, and right hand side, carbon tetrachloride and HCl products. So in the definition, I have indicated transition state or intermediates, but you cannot see in the stoichiometry that the transition state, that's an imaginary one, and intermediates are real. You can easily view only if you go for the mechanism, steps involved in mechanism. So, let me go for that. So, this is the mechanism. What is happening actually, that's an imagination, we call it a mechanism. I'm going to define any of it. Let me say, mechanism is defined as a hypothetical motion picture of the behavior of participating atoms in a molecule. That is called a mechanism. So, in this case, what are the steps involved? First step, chlorine attacks the methane to produce methyl chloride. Then, again, methyl chloride form. Again, chlorine attacks methyl chloride to produce methylene chloride. Further attacks by chlorine gives chloroform. And finally, carbon tetrachloride. The final product is carbon tetrachloride. Whereas, these three, methyl chloride, methylene chloride, and chloroform are intermediates. So, these intermediates you can see only in the mechanism. Okay. Regarding for transition state, I have already informed it is an imaginary that you have to imagine. So let me give a clear idea. What is substrate? What is the attacking reagent? What is products? What is intermediate transition state? Everything I will explain. First, what is a substrate? A substrate is a reactant where a carbon and a heteroatom bond breaks in organic chemistry. Substrate is a reactant, in this case methane, where a carbon and a heteroatom bond breaks and a new carbon heteroatom bond forms. Wherever it is, that is a substrate. So substrate is a reactant where a carbon and a heteroatom bond breaks and a new carbon heteroatom bond forms. Here I have already pointed out methane is a substrate. So just see the reaction here. 4 moles of chlorine react with 1 mole of methane to produce 1 mole of carbon tetrachloride and 4 moles of HCl in presence of light. H nu is indicated. This is the reaction. Okay, now just see here. In this, so that is, I have given this, that is, that the including the transition state I have given here to understand this. So actually what is happening? So this is, we have said, this is a methane, is a tetrahedron you are seeing here. And chlorine is attacking approaching this. So we are imagining a stage where chlorine-chlorine bond breaks and the carbon heteroatom bond breaks and a new carbon-chlorine bond forms. All these we are imagining in a single state. That state we are calling it as a transition state. Can you follow? A transition state is imaginary. Why I am calling it imaginary? Because carbon is having 5 valency, not at all possible. It's not at all possible. That's why I am calling it an imaginary. Just we are imagining. So, why I am showing this? Because to indicate a carbon substrate, that is, a carbon-hydrogen bond breaks, that is a heteroatom, simultaneously a carbon-chlorine new bond forms. Wherever it forms, it is called a substrate. That's why methane is a substrate. In order to give idea, I am showing this one. So, producing now methyl chloride and HCl. So, this is the transition state. Okay. Now, come forward. Let me go for the next one. Attacking reagent. Attacking reagent is generally an element or inorganic compound. This is the interesting information. Even if it is an organic, normally the inorganic, an element or inorganic compound will be used as an attacking reagent. So, substrate will be generally organic compound. That is the important information. So, if you take in this specific example, here chlorine is the attacking reagent and methane is the substrate. So chlorine attacks the methane to produce carbon tetrachloride and HCl, the fundamental reaction that you are studying, you have already studied under the even 9th and 10th book. So, let me repeat again. Methane is the substrate, the attacking reagent is chlorine. I have already pointed out, attacking reagent is generally an element or inorganic compound. Okay. Now, coming for the transition state, I have already explained to you what is transition state. It is only imaginary. Transition state is imaginary and cannot be isolated. We cannot isolate. So, transition state is imaginary and cannot be isolated. Just see the imaginary. That is, this you have seen already the slide again. This is the transition state. So, carbon-hydrogen bond breaks, carbon-chlorine bond forms simultaneously, you can imagine. That is transition state. So, in the case of methane reacts with chlorine, we are imagining this is the transition state. Each and every step in the reaction mechanism, we can imagine transition state. This is only to understand the mechanism. Okay, let me go for the next. What are intermediates? Intermediates are real. I have already pointed out, transition state imaginary, whereas intermediates are real, which can be isolated. We can isolate. So, for example, in this case, chlorination of methane, here, in front of sunlight, the product, the methyl chloride, methylene chloride, and the chloroform are intermediates. So, you have seen already. So, in this case, in this particular reaction, methyl chloride, methylene chloride, and chloroform are intermediates. This is the interesting information. Okay, now look at this. This is the steps involved. This we are calling it as mechanism. The steps involved in the chemical reaction to form products. So, methyl chloride, CH to Cl, methylene chloride, that is dichloromethane, CH to Cl2, and chloroform, that is CHCl3, are intermediates. So, carbon tetrachloride is a product. So, this CH3Cl, CH to Cl2, CHCl3 are intermediates. Here I want to give one information. Suppose, if I use only 1 mole of chlorine and if I use only 1 mole of methane, the reaction will stop at methyl chloride. It will not proceed further. Instead of that, if I use 2 moles of chlorine, then the product will stop at CH2Cl2. If I use 3 moles of chlorine, the product will stop at chloroform. Only if I use 4 moles or excess, the final product will be carbon tetrachloride. This is the most important information you must understand. So, whenever a product is formed in organic chemistry, we must indicate the moles of reactants on the substrate. That is very, very important. Then only we think of if the reaction will be completed or incompletely taking place, we have to assume. The next step. So what I have discussed, what is a chemical reaction, what are the reaction, what are these involved? That is the reactants, products, transition state and intermediate. I have explained all. So let me go for the types of chemical reaction. The chemical reaction, you can classify a number of ways. Inorganic point of view, physical point of view, organic point of view. But organic point of view, now I am going to classify only two types additionally. So these three types I am going to discuss under this. One is chemical reactions based on delta H value. This is mainly important for physical point of view. Based on delta H value, minus or plus, exothermic or endothermic. Second one, chemical reactions based on the nature of attacking reagent undergoing fission. This is the most important. As per mechanistic point of view. So chemical reactions based on the nature of attacking reagent undergoing fission is the most important type of chemical reaction we are studying, because here only we are going to understand what is mechanism, what are the types of mechanism. The third type, chemical reactions based on the nature of substrate molecule. This is another type of classification. So we can now identify, depending upon the nature of substrate, whether it's an aromatic or aliphatic, saturated or unsaturated, the types will vary. So let me go in detail of this. First, let me take the type 1, where the chemical reaction based on delta H value. Delta H means enthalpy in physical chemistry we have come across, studying under the thermodynamics. So, the whenever delta H value it is positive, we call it as endothermic. So endothermic reaction is one where heat is absorbed. The exothermic reaction is one where heat is evolved, heat is released. So in this case, I have given two specific examples. That is, one is PCl5, decomposition of PCl5 to produce PCl3 plus Cl2, delta H value, it is plus 15 kilojoules. In the formation of 2 moles of HI, here again energy is released, delta H value minus 3 kilojoules, it is an exothermic. I have already pointed out this is not important for us. So let me go for the next type, this is most important. That is, chemical reactions based on the nature of attacking reagent. This is the, we are interested. Let me go slowly with the kindly concentrate. Chemical reactions can also be classified based on the nature of attacking reagent. Based on the nature of attacking reagent, undergoing fission into two types. So depending upon the fission it is undergoing, nature of attacking reagent undergoing fission into two types, namely heterolytic reactions or ionic reaction. This is type 1. And homolytic reactions are free radical reaction. This is type 2. So, depending upon the nature of attacking reagent undergoing fission, we can classify entire organic reaction into two types. One is heterolytic reactions or ionic reaction, and another homolytic reactions or free radical reaction. This is the most important information. Okay, first let me take heterolytic reaction. Right? Heterolytic reaction. What is heterolytic reaction? A heterolytic reaction is one where the attacking reagent undergoes heterolytic fission. Hetero means different. Heterolytic fission to produce ion, positive and negative ions. And these ions are called electrophiles and nucleophiles. Positive ions are called electrophile and negative ions are called nucleophiles. So these ions are called electrophiles and nucleophiles, and this reaction is known as ionic reaction. This is the most important. So heterolytic reaction is known as ionic reaction, where positive ion and negative ions are produced. Positive ions we are calling it as electrophile and negative ions we are calling it as nucleophiles. This is the most important information. Here, in this specific example, chlorine from methane. So, chlorine is the attacking reagent which undergoes, that is, heterolytic fission to produce Cl plus and Cl minus. So, this is cleaving to Cl plus and Cl minus. Cl plus, electrophile. Cl minus, it is nucleophile. So, there are two types of ion. So, we are using electrophile for plus ion, nucleophile for
minus ion.
Okay, let me discuss. What is electrophil? What is nucleophil? Because question can be asked after this. What is an electrophil? So I am going to give now definition. Electrophil may be defined as species which may be neutral or positively charged, having affinity towards electrons. So this is called electrophil. So electrophil may be a neutral species or positively charged species, always having affinity towards electron. It will always move towards electron. So that we will call it as electrophil. So electrophil, neutral electrophils, example, borine, BH3 and aluminium chloride, specific example here I am giving, neutral electrophils. Whereas, positively charged electrophil, I am giving any speed, any positive ion, H plus, Cl plus, lithium plus, all plus ion. So here, I want to give some information for the student point of view. So, because question can be asked, one among the following is a neutral electrophil, one among the following is a positive electrophil, like this they will ask. So neutral electrophils, how to identify which one, which species, which is neutral will be acting as a neutral electrophil. Kindly have it in mind. According to this Lewis dot structures, when we are writing the dot structure for any molecule, any the corresponding central atom of any molecule, if the central atom is not having 8 electron in the outermost, if it is less than that, if it is less than that, that particular species, molecules, will act as neutral electrophils. The simplest way is, kindly recollect the periodic table. Under the periodic table, that is 13th group, boron family, that is boron, aluminium, gallium, indium, thallium is going on. So these family members, if they form any compound, they will act as neutral electrophil. That's why you have taken here two examples, BH3 and AlCl3. Aluminium chloride, aluminium bromide, aluminium iodide, anything, it will be neutral electrophil because the outermost only 3 electrons. So 3 electrons you will get from the hydrogen, so only 6 electrons in the outermost in the case of borane. So this is the interesting. So all these species will act as neutral electrophils. They will always move towards an electrons, so we are calling it as electrophils. This is the interesting information. The same way, now positively charged electrophil is very easy. So whenever any attacking reagent cleaved electrolytically, plus and minus, automatically positive, wherever it is, we'll call it as, it is, we are calling it as the electrophils. H plus, Cl plus, lithium plus are specific examples. Okay, let me go for the next one. Nucleophils. What is nucleophils? Nucleophils may be defined as species which may be neutral, again, which may be neutral or negatively charged, having affinity towards nucleus. This is the most important. So any species which may be neutral or negatively charged, having affinity towards nucleus. Nucleus is nothing but proton. Towards proton, we will call it as nucleophil. This is the most important information. Any species, it may be neutral or negatively charged, but if it is moving towards any nucleus, towards proton, positive charge, then it will be a nucleophil. So what's a neutral nucleophil? Water and ammonia, specific example, here I have given. Water and ammonia, specific example, water and ammonia. So why I am giving this specific example? Because in this neutral species, always there is lone pair. So any species having lone pair will always act as a neutral nucleophil. This is the most important information. So when you are writing, when you write the structure of water, so normally we will write the structure of water as this way. HOH, there will be two lone pair. So this lone pair will always move towards protons, that is nucleus. Same way, if you write ammonia also, there is again NH3, there is again a lone pair. The lone pair always move towards again proton. So that means this water and ammonia will act as neutral nucleophils. Kindly follow. The idea here it is, in organic chemistry, any molecule having lone pair will act as the neutral electrophile. Normally, alcohol, ether, aldehyde, ketones, all these compounds will come under this category. Okay. Let me come for the next one. Negatively charged nucleophiles. So nucleophile may be neutral or may be negatively charged. Again, this is very easy. So whenever any attacking agent cleaves electrolytically, one is plus, another will be minus. So minus will come under this category. Cl minus, OH minus, all this, etc. Examples of negatively charged nucleophile. So whenever any attacking reagent undergo fusion electrolytically, plus and minus will form. So plus will call it as electrophile, minus will call it as nucleophile. Okay, the next one. Under this electrophile and nucleophile, I have to introduce one more term. This is most important. That is carbonium ions and carbanions. This is very important in organic chemistry. What is carbonium ion? What is carbanion? Carbonium ion, the corresponding plus, carbanion, anion, corresponding minus. Very simple. So let me define now. What is carbonium ion? Carbonium ion may be defined as an electrophile. An electrophile where carbon atom is having a positive charge. This is very interesting information. So specific example, methyl carbonium ion, ethyl carbonium ion are specific example under this carbonium ion. So very simple. So I can define the other way. That is, any electrophile where carbon is having a positive charge, I will call it as carbonium ion. The same way, any nucleophile where carbon is having a negative charge, I will call it as carbanion. Very simple. So let me repeat again. Carbonium ion may be defined as an electrophile where carbon atom is having a positive charge. Specific example I have given. CH3 plus, CH3, CH2 plus. Okay. Carbanion. So carbanion may be defined as a nucleophile, anion, nucleophile, where carbon atom is having a negative charge. The same example, CH3 minus methyl carbanion, CH3 CH2 minus ethyl carbanion. So this is the specific example. Okay, so whenever we are discussing about the electrophile and nucleophile, you should have a clear idea. Electrophile may be carbonium ion with the car may not be carbonium ion, and again nucleophile may be carbanion, may not be carbanion. Just you have to think of. But if it is carbon is having a positive charge, we'll call it as carbonium ion. If carbon is a negative charge, we'll call it carbanion. Special name for that. So let me, this is the idea. Let me go for the next. Now, so far what I have discussed regarding for heterolytic fission, that is attacking reagent undergoing heterolytic fission, the corresponding reaction. Okay, let me go to the next one. Homolytic reactions are free radical reactions. In all these reactions, what will happen? The reagent will undergo fission homolytically, same way. So what is, let me see, what is homolytic reaction? Homolytic reaction is one where the attacking reagent undergoes homolytic fission, homo means same, homolytic fission, to produce radicals. So I am introducing a new term, radicals. Hence, these reactions are also called as free radical reactions. So heterolytic reaction, homolytic reactions are free radical reactions. So all homolytic reactions, we will call it as free radical reactions because radicals are produced. What way? By undergoing homolytic fission. Right. So hence, these reactions are called free radical reactions. All free radical reactions are initiated by either sunlight or by free radical, another free radical. So whenever you want to initiate any chemical reactions, that is homolytic reaction or free radical reaction, so we have to utilize either sunlight or free radical. That you can see from the over the arrow in the chemical reaction. So here in this specific example, chlorine Cl2 undergoes, that is in the presence of sunlight, to produce a radical Cl dot and Cl dot, because chlorine is a covalent molecule, Cl2 is the covalent molecule that is cleaved to Cl dot and Cl. The bond electron shared between two chlorine atoms is going along with one electron, one dot, another electron, another dot, another electron. So this we'll call it as chlorine free radical, chlorine radical or free radicals. So, inhomolytic reaction, free radical reactions are free radicals are formed, and these free radical reactions are initiated by sunlight or free radicals. This is the interesting information. Okay, with this basic idea, now let me go for the third type. That is third type of chemical reaction in organic chemistry. Chemical reactions based on nature of substrate molecule, which is the most nature of substrate molecule. So what would be nature? Say for example, the specific example I have discussed, methane. Methane is an aliphatic saturated molecule. Like that. So I can say when you say the substrate nature, it may be aliphatic or aromatic. If it is aliphatic, it may be saturated or unsaturated. If it is aromatic, it may be aryl or aryl-alkyl. So that depending upon the nature of the substrate molecule, I can classify the chemical reactions. So what are the types of chemical reactions under this? So let me discuss now. So types of chemical reactions based on the nature of substrate molecule. Number one, substitution reaction. Number two, addition reactions. Number three, elimination reactions. Number four, condensation reactions. Number five, polymerization reactions. Number six, isomerization reactions. Number seven, rearrangement reactions. And finally, number eight, pericyclic reactions. So there are eight types of chemical reaction I have classified here. So I will go in detail what is what I will explain now. First, let me take substitution reaction. This is the most important reaction. What is substitution reaction? Let me define first. Substitution reaction is one where an atom or group of atoms of the substrate molecule is substituted by an atom or group of atoms of attacking reagent. So this is the substitution reaction. So let me repeat again. Substitution reaction is one where an atom or group of atoms of the substrate molecule is substituted by an atom or group of atoms of attacking reagent. So in this specific example, methane reacts with the chlorine to produce carbon tetrachloride and HCl. So here, what is substituted? Hydrogen atom of the methane is substituted by chlorine atom of the attacking reagent chlorine. This is the specific example. So, these substitution reactions, I can classify into, there are two types again. There are two types of substitution. One is free radical substitution and ionic substitution. Suppose, if the attacking reagent undergoing homolytic fission, a free radical produces and free radical is substituting these the substrate molecule, then we will call it as free radical substitutions. And suppose, if the attacking reagent undergoes heterolytic substitution producing ions, then ions are substituting the substrate, then we will call it as ionic substitutions. So, substitution reaction, again we can classify into two types. One is free radical substitution, another is ionic substitutions. So, I will go in detail of individual. First, free radical substitutions, I have already indicated, are initiated by light or free radicals. Free radical substitutions are initiated by light or free radicals. So the example I have given here, when I start the lecture, methane, a specific example, let me show you now. A specific example, methane plus chlorine, this is how I discussed, in presence of sunlight, the product will be carbon tetrachloride plus HCl. So this is, here light is initiated, so this is a free radical. The same way, another example, the free radical will be introduced, another specific example you might have studied already in your 10th, that is propene, that is propene reacts with the HBr in presence of peroxide, the product again. So product is forming now CH2CH2Br. So one bromo propane. So in this case, peroxide is acting as the actually reagent that is in process of peroxide. It is the peroxide is in a reagent now it is used here to undergo free radical reaction. So it is initiating the reaction. So free radical reaction. So I have given two examples. One is light is involved. Example methane plus chlorine gives carbon tetrahydride HCl. Another case propene plus HBr producing 1-bromopropane or propyl bromide. Here peroxide, perbenzoic acid is commonly used. So this is a specific example you must know. So free radical substitutions are initiated by light and free radical. Two examples I have already quoted. Find out. The next one. Ionic substitutions are initiated by the reagents which provide electrophils and nucleophiles. The reagent which provide electrophils and nucleophiles. So this is the interesting information. Ionic substitutions. What way? Suppose you can take a specific example. Suppose we have methyl chloride. We are treating with sodium hydroxide. So now we'll say sodium hydroxide attacking reagent OH minus nucleophile. So sodium hydroxide is the reagent which will provide a nucleophile. So nucleophilic substitution taking place. So in this case, nucleophilic substitution taking place. Suppose it take methane and nitration of methane, nitric acid, attack of nitric acid. So what will happen now in this case, nitromethane is formed, NO2CH3. Nitromethane is formed plus water. So in this case, NO2 plus, that is, we will call it the electrophil, is now attacking. So here, ionic substitutions are initiated by the reagents, which provide electrophils and nucleophils. Sodium hydroxide, nucleophile is provided by sodium hydroxide. In the case of nitric acid, attack of nitric acid, that is NO2 plus electrophile is provided by nitric acid. So, ionic substitutions are initiated by the reagent which provide electrophiles and nucleophiles. I have given examples. Okay, let me go to the next. Now, the free radical example just now already pointed out that this is the specific example producing. So, light is involved. The next one. Coming for the ionic substitution, I have given a specific example. I can classify, depending upon the nature, into four types again. But wait, suppose the substrate, nature of the substrate, if it's an aliphatic, then I can classify into two. That is, aliphatic electrophilic substitution, then aliphatic nucleophilic substitution. So, if the substrate is an aliphatic compound, the ionic substitute I can classify into two types. One is aliphatic electrophilic substitution, another is aliphatic nucleophilic substitution. Suppose if the substrate is an aromatic substrate compound, so I can further classify aromatic electrophilic substitution, another is aromatic nucleophilic substitution. So the interesting information just I want to give it. So ionic substitution in organic chemistry, ionic, when I say ionic substitutions, so ionic substitution I can classify into four types. One is aliphatic electrophilic substitution, aliphatic nucleophilic substitutions, aromatic electrophilic substitution, and aromatic nucleophilic substitution. So these are the four important substitution reactions we have to study under the ionic substitutions. Okay, let me go further. Now, under this aliphatic electrophilic substitution, I will give one example. Just now I have informed, here I have seen, that is attack of, that is nitration of methane. Nitration of methane to produce nitromethane plus water. This is a specific example. So here, nitric acid is the attacking reagent. Methane is the substrate. Product is nitromethane and water. Okay. In this case, what is happening? The nitric acid, HNO3, now it is undergoing heterolytic fission. What way? It is becoming NO2 plus. This is becoming OH minus. It is undergoing cleavage. NO2 plus and OH minus. So this NO2 plus is only substituting the H plus to produce nitromethane. Then automatically OH minus and the H plus coming out will form water. So it is called a specific example of, since the methane is an aliphatic compound, substitution is the electrophilic, that is NO2 plus. So this is called aliphatic electrophilic substitution. Aliphatic. So by looking into the nature of substrate, we decide this. So this is an example of aliphatic electrophilic substitution. Now coming for aliphatic nucleophilic substitution, here I have one example. That is, the So the attack of sodium hydroxide on methyl chloride to produce methanol and sodium chloride. This is our example. So again, kindly follow the substrate here, it is methyl chloride. Attacking reagent is sodium hydroxide. So under the substrate, that is the methyl chloride under the substrate. So it is a saturated compound, aliphatic compound. So aliphatic compound. So now what will happen now? Sodium hydroxide undergoes in that is heterolytic fission to produce sodium plus and OH minus. So the OH minus going to substrate. OH minus nothing but a nucleophile. And the substrate is an aliphatic. So we will call it as aliphatic nucleophilic substitution. This is an example. So that means Cl minus is substituted by OH minus to produce methanol and sodium chloride. So this is an example of aliphatic nucleophilic substitution there. Now, here I want to give one information. Kindly follow. This is a generalization you must remember. Generally, aliphatic compounds generally undergo nucleophilic substitution rather than electrophilic substitution. So if you take aliphatic compounds and if you study all the reactions of substitution reactions, so we can classify into two types. One is aliphatic electrophilic substitution and aliphatic nucleophilic substitution. And now substitutions, we can study the two types, aliphatic electrophilic substitution and aliphatic nucleophilic substitution. You can have a number of reactions, but it is observed experimentally generally aliphatic compound undergo nucleophilic substitution rather than electrophilic. Instead of electrophilic, it is commonly undergoes nucleophilic substitution. This is experimental fact, evidence. Based on the experimental evidence, this is, we are giving a generalization. Okay, let me go to the next one. Next, we'll come for the aromatic side. So first, let me take aromatic electrophilic substitution. A specific example is benzene reacts with concentrated nitric acid to produce nitrobenzene and water. This is a specific example coming under the aromatic electrophilic substitution. So as in the previous case, what is happening now? Here, nitric acid will be cleaved in this form, H2O NO2. It is producing, that is, NO2 plus and OH minus. NO2 plus and in this side, OH minus. So here, NO2 plus is going to attack the benzene ring. So from benzene, hydrogen plus is coming out. So that hydrogen plus is coming and reacting with OH minus to produce water. So NO2 plus is attacking, entering into the ring. So it is called aromatic. Why we are calling it aromatic? Because benzene is an aromatic compound. So the electrophile is NO2 plus. So it is called aromatic electrophilic substitution. So this is, so nitration of benzene to produce nitrobenzene is an example of aromatic electrophilic substitution. Here again, as usual, I want to generalize one. The generalization is, generally, aromatic compounds undergo electrophilic substitution rather than nucleophilic substitution. This is the important information you must have it in mind. So when you take aromatic compounds, generally, aromatic compound will undergo both electrophilic as well as nucleophilic, but common, generally, it is more, that is, aromatic compound undergo electrophilic substitution more than, rather than nucleophilic substitution. Reason is, in benzene, we know already there are 3 pi electrons are there. This is one of the resonance structures of benzene. So if you write number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5, this is number 6. Again, number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5, number 6. So there are 2 resonance structures we can write for a benzene. So the general representation is, this is the general representation for a benzene structure. This is the general representation for benzene structure, that is structure 1, the 1 and 2. The idea here it is, so this, why this benzene is generally, the benzene molecule undergo electrophilic substitution? Because there are 3 pi bonds, 3 into 2, 6 pi electrons is there. So throughout the ring, a negative charge is there. Negative means positive will easily attack. That's why generally, the aromatic compounds undergo electrophilic substitution rather than nucleophilic substitution. When nucleophile come to the nearer to the benzene ring, Well, they, because the negative repulsion will be there. So generally, it will not take place. If you want to conduct any aromatic nucleophilic substitution reactions, only under drastic and high temperature and pressure is required. Let me go further. So, let me conclude now by saying, aromatic compound generally undergo electrophilic substitution rather than nucleophilic substitution. Okay, let me go for next. Another type, that is aromatic nucleophilic substitution. We have now generally again, generally I have already informed you, again repeating now. Generally, aromatic compounds do not undergo nucleophilic substitution under ordinary conditions. Under ordinary conditions they will not undergo. But if you want to conduct, takes place only under drastic condition. Drastic, very high pressure, very high temperature, we have to maintain, then only we will get that product. The specific example is, that is, the chlorobenzene reacts with sodium hydroxide at a high temperature and pressure to produce phenol and sodium chloride. So, if you want to convert the, that is, substitute chlorine by sodium hydroxide, a nucleophilic substitution reaction, you want to remove Cl- and to add OH- means very, very difficult. So this will take place only under drastic condition. We have to maintain high temperature and high pressure. Ordinary way we cannot. So the one interesting information I want to give under this, that is the aromatic compound undergo electrophilic substitution reaction is, you take aniline, you take phenol, simply add bromine water without heating, even at ordinary room temperature, you undergo, that is, simple substitution reaction. Even at room temperature, we can say without heating, it will taking place. It shows again, it is a favor, indicating a very clear idea. Generally, aromatic compound undergo electrophilic substitution rather than nucleophilic substitution. Okay, let me go for the next one. So far I have discussed substitution reactions. Next, let me go for addition reactions. What is addition reaction? So the addition reaction is specific. This will take place only the substrate molecules and unsaturated molecules. This is the most important information. So addition where will take place? Addition takes place only if it is the substrate molecules and unsaturated part. Okay, let me say now. Addition reaction is one where an unsaturated substrate, kindly have it in mind. Substrate should be an unsaturated. Unsaturated substrate molecule undergoes chemical reaction to produce a saturated product. So, substrate will be unsaturated, product will be saturated. Whenever, so that is the specific example. So, normally addition takes place, addition reaction takes place. So, kindly, a specific example here, ethylene reacts with HBr to produce 1-bromoethane or ethyl bromide. This is a specific example, undergoes addition reactions. So, as usual, again, addition reaction also we can classify further if you want. That is what way? That is the electrophilic addition and nucleophilic addition like that we can. Okay, let me go for the next one. So, under the addition reactions, I want to give further informations. There are two important information I want to record here. One is, generally, alkenes and alkynes, unsaturated substrate, alkenes, and alkyne. Alkenes containing double bond between carbon-carbon. Alkynes between triple bond between carbon-carbon. Generally, alkenes and alkynes undergo electrophilic addition first, followed by nucleophilic addition. This is the interesting information. Whenever addition reaction takes place, the question arises. Because attacking reagent will contain both electrophil and nucleophil. The question arises now, which will add first to the unsaturated substrate? Either electrophil add first and nucleophil add first. So now the information is, generally, alkenes and alkynes undergo electrophilic addition first. Electrophilic addition first, followed by nucleophilic addition. Whereas, with aldehydes and the ketones, again there is unsaturation, aldehyde, C double bond O, CH double bond O, ketone C double bond O. Aldehydes and ketones undergo nucleophilic addition first, followed by electrophilic addition. This is the most important information. This is the interesting information. So, kindly here I have given two specific examples here. That is CH2 double bonds ethylene plus HBr giving ethyl bromide. The second case, acetaldehyde CN gives acetaldehyde cyanohydrin, CH3CHOACN. Both cases. The interesting information, in the first case, because ethylene is an unsaturated compound, alkene, so first electrophile, H plus will add first, followed by Br minus. The second case, CN minus add first, then followed by H plus. This is the interesting information you must know. So that is regarding for addition reactions. Now, third types of reaction, elimination reaction. How can I define elimination reaction? Elimination reaction is one where a saturated organic molecule undergoes chemical reaction to produce an unsaturated product. Kindly follow. Just reverse of addition. That is, elimination reaction is one where a saturated organic molecule undergoes chemical reaction to produce unsaturated product. Substrate will be saturated, product will be unsaturated. Just a reverse of addition. In addition, substrate is unsaturated, product is saturated. Here reverse. So in this specific example, so ethyl bromide reacts with the alcoholic KOH to produce ethylene, an unsaturated product, KBr and water. So product here unsaturated, the substrate here it is saturated. Ethyl bromide is a saturated substrate, ethylene is the product, unsaturated product. This is the interesting information we can. So kindly follow, the reagent is alcoholic KOH, is commonly used for elimination reactions. So this is the third type. The fourth type, condensation reaction. What is condensation reaction? I can define now. Condensation reaction is one where one or more molecules, same or different, undergo chemical combination to produce product with or without elimination of some simple molecules. This is called the condensation reaction. Let me repeat again. Condensation reaction is one where one or more molecules, same or different, undergo chemical combination to produce product with or without elimination of some simple molecules. A specific example here, that is aldol condensation I have given. That is two molecules of acetaldehyde undergo condensation in presence of potassium hydroxide or sodium hydroxide to produce aldol. This is aldol. So if you want to give the IUPAC name for this one, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4. That means this is 3. Hydroxybutane 1-AL IUPAC name. That is the common name is aldol. So here there is no elimination of simple molecules. But two molecules, same molecules, acetaldehyde undergo chemical combination to produce the product. That is all. This is called aldol condensation. So when you come for the, when you study for organic chemistry, you will be come across under the aldehyde and ketone a number of condensation reactions. So this is the most important type. Another type. Let me go to the next one. The fifth one. Polymerization reaction. This is another important reaction. What is polymerization reaction? Polymerization reaction is one where large number of substrate molecules with or without attacking reagents. Large number of substrate molecules with or without attacking reagent in large number undergo polymerization to produce a polymer. So let me define now. Let me repeat again. Polymerization reaction is one where large number of substrate molecules with or without attacking reagents in large number undergo polymerization to produce a polymer. Polymer means a product having very, very high molecular weight. A specific example here I have given, there is ethylene, ethene. N number, N may be any number, it may be 100, it may be 1000, it may be lakhs, any number, depending upon the quantity you require. N number of ethylene undergo polymerization in presence of high temperature, 200 degree temperature and 1000 atmosphere, it will undergo polymerization to produce polythene, the bag we are using, polythene. So ethylene undergoes polymerization to produce polyethylene or polyethylene, we call it as. This is the specific example of polymerization reaction. Same way, the number of polymerization is you can come across. That is, vinyl chloride same way will undergo PVC, polyvinyl chloride, the same way. Okay, let me go for the next type. The sixth type, isomerization reaction. This is another important types of organic reactions. Isomerization reaction. We know we have come across already. What is an isomer? That is, compounds having same molecular formula but different, same molecular formula but different physical and chemical properties are called isomers, and the phenomenon exhibited by this isomer is called isomerization. So different isomer, molecular formula will be same and different isomer. So different types of isomerism will be discussed. So one isomer will be converted to another isomer, will call it as isomerization reaction. So let me define now. Isomerization reaction is one where one isomeric substrate molecule will be converted into another isomeric product. So substrate will be one isomer, product will be another isomer. So in this case, a specific example, I have given N-butane undergoes isomerization to produce isobutane. So normal chain will be converted to branched chain. This is the idea. So it is now one isomer. So what is the isomer here? The example, this is nothing but chain isomer. N-butane and isobutane are examples of chain isomers. Chain isomers. So N-butane normal chain converted into branched chain isobutane. So this is a specific example of isomerization reaction. Next one. A rearrangement reaction. This is another interesting reaction we have come across in organic chemistry. What is a rearrangement reaction? A rearrangement reaction is one where an atom or group of atoms will migrate from one place to another in a molecule. One place to another in a molecule, from one atom to another atom in a molecule to produce a rearranged product. The product will rearrange, the bond will be rearranged, the atom will rearrange. So let me repeat again. A rearrangement reaction is one where an atom or group of atoms will migrate from one place to another in a molecule to produce a rearranged product. A specific example here I want to give. Example is pinacol-pinacolone rearrangement. Another example, normally in higher secondary level, Hoffman rearrangement will be given. So here I want to give a specific example, pinacol-pinacolone rearrangement. Kindly see here what is happening. So in this specific reaction, kindly see, there is nothing but, see, there are, it's a diol, 1, 2, 3, 4 methyl groups are there. Actually, if you want to give IUPAC name for this, so let me give now this 1, 2, 3, 4. It is 2, 3 dimethyl butane 2, 3 diol. That is the IUPAC name. Common name is pinacol. So what is happening now? In presence of acid medium, this is undergoes rearrangement. What way? One methyl group from this side migrates going to this carbon atom, see here. Then, here from this, a hydrogen atom is migrating to this and getting eliminated in the form of water molecule. All this rearrangement taking place. So, product we are calling it as pinacolone, a ketone. It's a ketone, pinacolone. So, this is the specific example of the rearrangement reaction. Pinacol, pinacolone rearrangement. This is a specific example. Okay, let me go to the next one. The next one is the pericyclic reaction. This is normally will not be given in our high secondary book. Anyhow, kindly note it. Pericyclic reactions. What is pericyclic reaction? Here I have given a specific, a number of types of pericycling is there. So here I have given one example. Pericyclic reaction is one where the substrate molecule will undergo neither ionic nor free radical. So far what we have discussed? Either ionic or free radical only we have discussed. That one more. That is through transition state that we are calling it as pericyclic reactions. So pericyclic reaction is one where the substrate molecule will undergo neither ionic nor free radical but react through transition state. We have already discussed transition state is imaginary. So that through imaginary. So specific example, the name of the reaction is called a Diels-Alder reaction. Beside this name itself in given, Diels-Alder reaction. Here, 1,3-butadiene, commonly called as diene, This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 3 beta diene. Diene. So this is ethylene. We are calling it a dienophil. So ethylene reacts with 1, 3 beta diene. So it is undergoing a reaction to produce the cyclohexene. So this is a specific example of the pericyclic reactions. And this is, that is depending upon the heat or in terms of sunlight, that depending upon this condition, this will take place. So this is the different types of chemical reactions. So for what I have discussed, what is a chemical reactions? What are the types of chemical reactions I have discussed? Now let me go for the next one. Mechanism. What is mechanism? I have already showed you that is the steps involved in the chemical reactions. Okay, let me show you now. I can define the exact definition given by the Gould. What is mechanism? Mechanism may be defined as a hypothetical motion picture. Hypothetical motion picture of the behavior of participating atom in a molecule. This is called mechanism. Let me repeat again. Mechanism may be defined as a hypothetical motion picture of the behavior of participating atoms in a molecule. So in a molecule, when a reactant react to produce product, how atoms will migrate one place to another, how it is rearranging, how it is substituting, how it is undergoing addition, all these imaginary picture that is taking place in an atom in a molecule, you call it as mechanism. So mechanism may be defined as a hypothetical motion picture of the behavior of participating atom in a molecule. This is called mechanism. So when you say mechanism, I can clarify the specific example I have already pointed out, that this is the pinacol converted into pinacolone. This is mechanism. So correct, because why I am this specific example, here so many things happening. So methyl groups is getting migrating, imagine. And here from this OH is going out. And from here, H is going out. So all this taking place, imagine. So H is going and combining as OH in the form of water. One methyl group is migrating from this carbon to another carbon. All this imagination, we are calling it as mechanism. That's why this specific example I have given to imagine. So it is called mechanisms. So the mechanism I can broadly classify into two types. One is free radical mechanism, another is ionic mechanism. So, whenever a free radical is involved in any chemical reaction, the corresponding mechanism will call it as free radical mechanism. Whenever in any chemical reaction, ions are involved in any chemical reaction, the corresponding mechanism will call it as ionic mechanism. Very simple. So, here kindly students remember this. Very simple. So, whenever you are studying any chemistry book, any notes, kindly see, just see the reactions. Over the arrow, over the arrow, if any light is involved, H nu, or light is involved, or any, the peroxide is involved, that is due to free radical mechanism. The reaction will be due to free radical. Without indicating anything, simply reagent, we have to assume it is ionic mechanism. This is the convention. This is the convention we are following in the organic chemistry. So, let me conclude now. So, reaction mechanism can be classified into two types. One is free radical mechanism, another is ionic mechanism. Okay. So how to understand? What are the methods to determine the mechanism? How to understand the mechanism? How to know what are the steps involved, how to migrate, how to rearrange, everything. So what are the methods? So methods of determining mechanism. How to determine? So there are a number of methods available. Number one, identification of products. We can. So by identifying the product form, we can determine the mechanism. What is taking place, how it is taking place, how it is rearing. So from the product form, we can. Number two, isolation of product, we can. So by isolating the product, we can. In some cases, we can isolate product, but some cases we cannot isolate, but we know the product. Right. The third is, by detection of intermediate, we can determine the mechanism. Trapping of intermediate, we can determine the mechanism. Addition of a suspected intermediate, we can determine the mechanism. By isotopic labeling, we can determine mechanism. By kinetic evidence, we can determine mechanism. By determining the order of the reaction, we can determine the mechanism. by stereochemical evidence, we can determine mechanism. The stereochemical evidence means, in the case of optical active compounds, we're measuring optical activity. In the case of systems isomer, measuring dipole movement, etc. We can. So, by using these methods, the identification of products, isolation of products, detection of intermediates, trapping of intermediates, addition of suspected intermediates, then isotopic labeling, kinetic evidence, and the stereochemical evidence, now we can determine the mechanisms. So by any one of these methods, or any one or more more of these methods, by following this method, we can determine mechanisms. So let me continue now. So far, what I have listed, what is the chemical reaction, what are the types of chemical reactions, then what is the mechanism, so what are the methods we can determine mechanism. So I will not go in detail of method because this is higher level. So what I will go next is, so in order to understand the mechanism, some we are in need of some information. What are they? Let me give you now. That is, in order to understand the mechanism, we must understand electron displacement effect. This is the most important. Electron displacement effect is most important if you want to understand mechanism. To understand mechanism, we have to study electron displacement effect. What are the electron displacement? One, inductive effect. Number one, inductive effect. Number two, electromeric effect. Number three, hyperconjugation effect. Number four, mesomeric effect. Or another name, a resonance effect. And five, steric effect. So these are the five electron displacement effect we have to study. Only if you understand fully these effects, we can understand the mechanism. We can answer any question in organic chemistry, preparation properties, any reason question, we can. I hope I can stop here. So you have enjoyed the lecture. I will continue the next class.